Alrighty, it's that time of year that you truly start having a moment of truth in your colonies as you prepare them for winter. And I know that many of you will go in your colonies and you will see this and you'll think, what is going on? I know I was thinking this last year when I first saw it, so I'm gonna show you and give you a little bit of an explanation. All right, so I should probably throw my gloves on first before I start going into this colony because it is that time of year that the bees are a little bit cranky, so just be aware. And we got a lot of action today. It's been an absolutely beautiful day and they are currently on a goldenrod flow, so it's nice to finally see they have some food coming in because they definitely needed it. Now I did go through all of my colonies around 5 days ago and equalized, added brood to wheat colonies and whatnot. So everything's looking really strong and really, really good. But, okay, so in this colony we're about to go through, what I'm seeing is that the brood pattern is not how it normally would look. So have you ever gone into your colony, especially this time of year, and seen that it looks like your brood pattern is very sporadic? I'm gonna show you an example in here once I open up this colony. But you'll see that your brood pattern is very sporadic, and then it's like your colony is just struggling to get up in size. They're not bringing in a lot of honey because they don't have a whole lot of bees either, so it's hard to really try to strengthen your hive when they look like this. So let me show you an example. All right, so hopefully I don't regret this since I'm not using smoke, but I guess we'll see. So it looks like this colony is doing a little bit better as the population sizes came up. That is something that makes me really happy to see because it wasn't very good last time I was in here. All right, here is a perfect example on a frame. Yes, this is leftover, okay. So you see how there are spread out cappings all around this, and then when you look closer, you see that there are larvae and eggs in all of these, but they're not evenly filled and whatnot. And then do you see that right there? That cell that has a piece of brood in it that looks like it appears to be melted, or maybe even look at that one right there that is uncapped. Or even that one right there that is uncapped and appears to be chewed down on, like it had the head bit off of it. So all of this that I'm seeing is telling me that I have a problem with mites in here. This would be referred to as parasitic mite syndrome. And it's often confused with different brood diseases because it appears like a brood disease, because you're like, okay, the brood is starting to die. They're uncapping the cells. The brood looks melted down and you can't really figure out what's going on. Well, that is parasitic mite syndrome. So that means that this colony had a high mite load. And what ended up happening is when the queen started laying eggs again, because this colony in particular just requeened. This was a split that I did. And then I let them make their own queen and let her mate and whatnot. Well, now that she's came back and when she started laying that first round of brood, what ended up happening is all the mites that were in this hive then stormed all the cells and they started feeding on all of this brood. Now, the problem with that is that when the mites start feeding on the brood, they're going to weaken the brood and they're also going to give it different, viruses and diseases and whatnot, because that's what mites carry, unfortunately. So, what you're seeing here is larvae that ended up dying because of the mites. Because the larvae that was in each one of those cells, there is not enough food to go around for all of the mites that ended up going into those cells. So that ended up making all of the larvae die, and that's what you're seeing here. And on top of that, this hive in particular is showing some hygienic behavior, the fact that they are uncapping cells like this. That means that they're smelling the varroa underneath the wax capping, and smelling the different pheromones that varroa produces. I believe it's pheromones. A lot of times the bees will be able to smell the feces of the mites, and that's how they're able to tell that there are mites in there. And so they will uncap the cell, pull out the larva, so that it disrupts that reproduction cycle of the mites, because mites can only reproduce when they're in the cell. So that being said, that is what you see when you go into your hive and you see a frame that looks like this. Now it can be a little bit alarming to see this, especially if you don't see any of the symptoms getting better, and especially if the queen in this hive has been the same queen that's been in here the whole entire summer. Then most likely you've had a really high mite level this whole entire time, and now you're starting to see the effects of that mite level. So what I'd recommend is definitely, in this instance, the only option you really have to save your hive is to put a treatment on. Yes, I know I'm treatment free, but if you are wanting to just save the colony, that's really only gonna be your best bet. Unless you wanna start all over, but really it's late in the year, so you can't really do that either. But yeah. Now let's talk about this one over here. The one that looks like its head was eaten off of, that would be called bald brood. And what research has shown was that whenever you see bald brood in your colony like this, that had its head like gnawed off, like the bees started eating at it, that is because that larva had a very high level of deformed wing virus. Now you might think, oh my gosh, that's not good. Now the deformed wing virus is gonna spread throughout the entire colony. But actually, this is a really, really good thing, the fact that the bees do this, because that little thing I always talk about, vitellogenin, that is what helps the bee's immune system. So what ends up happening is the bee ingests this virus through their mouth, and then it's transported through the vitellogenin immune transport. And then they're able to put it into the brood food that the bees make themselves and spit back out into the cells. Well, they don't spit it. I believe they have glands for it. Back out into the cells for the new emerging larva and producing larva, so that they are able to eat. So what happens is when they're moving that virus into the brood food, they're pretty much forming what would be called like a vaccine. I really hate saying that word, but that is pretty much what they're doing to kind of help explain it a little bit. And don't mind my notes up there. I was trying to make notes so I would stay on topic. You guys know me. But yeah, so this vitellogenin is able to help the next round of brood be even stronger. And the idea with this is that then the next round of brood is going to be immune to that virus. And do you guys see this like little fight that's going on over here? I don't know what this... Oh! What does it have in its hands? Do you see that? What is that? Is that like a little like... Oh, that's a little bug it has in its paws. Look at it. It is killing something. Well, that is cool. I think it's trying to kill a... It kind of looks like a wild bee that might have flown in there. Because I have this frame out and open. Ah, that is so cool. But anyways, okay, back to what I was saying before this bee was starting to fight over here, and it looks like they're all like forming a circle around it and cheering them on. But anyways, so, oh, look at that. They are just fighting these today. Sorry, I have you guys open, so I'm sure you guys are like, what the heck? Now we gotta defend ourselves from robbers. Yeah, sorry about that, guys, but I need to do a little bit of a demonstration. But okay, all right. What I was talking about. So, those viruses, they can be detrimental to the colony. So this is something that is huge, the fact that the bees do this, because that makes it so the next generation is then able to fight off that virus, and then maybe one day we won't have any problems with deformed wing virus. Last year, I did have a colony that had bad deformed wing virus, if you guys remember. And I was really nervous about it. And what I ended up doing is I combined it with another colony to help strengthen it a little bit. And then I just overwintered it. And to my surprise, it actually survived. Now, I have not seen deformed wing virus again in any of these colonies yet.
But you usually don't see it until around October. That's when you're really going to start seeing some sicknesses in your colony if they are struggling to fight off the viruses. But if they have enough food and they have a low number of mites, then they're going to be able to fight off almost anything that they face. Now, okay, I shouldn't say that because that sounds like an absolute. There could be other things that could really put a hit on them. But for the most part, they're a lot like us. In fact, that if they were to get a sickness, they have a way and they have means to be able to fight it off. That is actually why they will let a bee that is sick and infected stay in the hive so that they can still transfer spit and get the virus in small amounts into their body so they can then form that vaccine I was talking about. Then after that, they'll kick that bee out because they're like, yep, no, you can't get any more bees sick, so get out. But pretty ruthless little things, aren't they? Oh, we got a little dancing bee over here. They must have found something. God, I love bees. But in terms of hygienic behavior, so in the past, a lot of us beekeepers didn't really understand what hygienic behavior was. So when we'd go in a colony and saw that their brood pattern was not absolutely perfect, we were like, oh, well, maybe we don't have a good queen. Yeah, let's cut her. Well, it turns out that when we were seeing some of those brood patterns not being super full and perfect, that was actually the hygienic behavior that was being performed. So the best tell for seeing if you have a good queen now is seeing what their brood pattern looks like when they're laying eggs, what their egg laying pattern looks like. If they're laying sheets on sheets of eggs, then most likely you definitely have a really good queen. But hygienic behavior can be so important for the health of your colony because now they're able to manage varroa on their own instead of having to have any interventions from you. Now, another thing that I've noticed in colonies that have a really high mite load is the bees. Okay, so they are really, really freaking smart. And if they have a high mite load, I've noticed that they will then supersede their queen so that they force themselves to have a brood break. And if they don't end up doing that and they have a really high population of bees, I've even seen them force the queen to slow down. Now, I don't know if this is because the mite level was so high or if it was because of the time of year, but I have noticed that they will force the queen to slow down so she is laying as little as possible so they have that little bit of a brood break. And like I mentioned before, the theory with the brood break is that all the mites that are on the bees, or all the mites that were in the cells will then have to go onto the bees. And then when that happens, all of those bees... Sorry. And then when that happens, all of those mites will then storm the cells on the first round of eggs that the queen lays. And what will end up happening is, like I said, there will not be enough food to go around for the mites, so they'll end up starving to death because there'll be more mites per cell than there normally would be. That is why you would also see what you're seeing here on this frame. Yeah, I've noticed that the queen will kind of slow down a little bit. The bees will force her to do that so that they get that brood break. And yeah, so some of these other cells, these other frames are looking kind of like eh. This is not what you want to see in a colony, especially this time of year. Yeah, she's got eggs in all of these cells, so they're going to end up being okay. Now that they're getting a good enough start. But when I first went in here, I was like, oh no, they have some sort of bad brood disease. I have no idea what this is. Then I just closed it up, went home, was like, okay, I'm just going to think about it. Then I was like, wait a second, I've seen this before. This looks like parasitic mite syndrome. I bet you this is because of the brood break they got when they were waiting for their new queen. So I'm going to keep an eye on this colony and see how it progresses going into winter time and see what happens. They are starting to put on some honey, which makes me really happy because they were pretty light beforehand. That will also cause them to not lay as heavy as they normally would if they don't have enough food, because the bees, like, they're smart. They'll take note of, take stock of everything that they have in the colony and then plan accordingly. But okay, that was a short little quick explanation of what you may be seeing. I hope that was helpful and I'll see you guys soon. Don't quit and be fit.